I'm Ido Levin. I'm the media officer with the CEE Bankwatch Network. Maybe just quickly, we are here today to discuss ahead of the EIB's, the European Investment Bank's press conference next week. We are here to discuss some of the things, particularly on the bank's climate and energy investments in the past year. And so we will have Anna Roggenbuck, who is the EIB policy officer in Bankwatch, and Xavier Sol, who is the director of Counterbalance, discussing different aspects of this. Anna will be talking about the bank's energy lending over the past 5 years. And she will also present some of her recommendations on what it would take for the EIB to become finally a climate leader. Xavier will be discussing the challenges in the in this year, specifically on the climate and energy front. And I guess we're ready to start. Anna, the floor is yours.
Thank you. So the question is how to turn the bank from climate laggard to climate leader. And I am pretty sure that tomorrow, president of the EIB on its conference will present the bank as a climate leader and will show some figures related to its climate lending. But there is a second, there's a different side of that climate performance is also EIB's investments in fossil fuels. So as you can see that over the 5 years, EIB's lending to fossil fuels investments was on a pretty high level. At least $1.5 billion annually. There were some peaks and depressions over this period. However, on average, at least $2 billion annually, €2 billion, have been invested in fossil fuels infrastructure. This is mainly this fossil fuel lending. It's actually mainly characterized by its support to gas infrastructure. And EIB's addiction to gas is very visible because it's at least 90% of the EIB's fossil fuels lending. And it continues supporting gas transmission, distribution, and storage, but also gas extraction and electricity production from gas. This gas lending takes place mainly in three countries, and this is Italy, Spain, and UK. And what's very interesting that actually it in Italy, EIB's lending to gas is more than half, almost around half of the EIB's lending, energy lending in this country, and 40% of the entire gas lending of the EIB is for this very country. So we can see that there is over this time systemic support that EIB provides to gas networks developments and gas infrastructure development in couple of countries. And we think that for EIB to become a real climate leader, the bank would have to do something with this. And this would be avoid the risk of locking in to this kind of infrastructure and carbon assets by explicitly committing to halt fossil fuel support. There is also another way how EIB supports coal business, and EIB still support development of companies that produce heat and power mainly from coal. It uses a backdoor financing. So it finances these companies through various of projects, including their electricity transmission and distribution, or renewables of these companies. But it does provide this company level financing, and the level of this financing over the 4 years, 2013 and 17, because for the last year we still don't have data, reached almost 4 billion euro. So we can see that this lending continues, especially in Poland and in Spain, and there is also support in some other countries. Again, how to change this, and how to make the EIB really the real climate leader? Our answer would be that because of the infrastructure that EIB supports with this company level lending is important. So we don't recommend halting this support to such companies entirely, but we insist that this financing to be conditioned on binding decarbonization plans that these companies should have in place, and also there should commit not to expand further coal projects. Then there is also a third side of the EIB's climate the second side of the EIB's climate action, which is not really in action, or is in action only in some places. The share of energy efficiency lending of the EIB in various countries of the EU really vary a lot between different countries, and we see that this is problematic, because climate action is only takes place in some countries, whereas in the others is very minimal, or even in some countries non-existing. The same happens with lending to renewables. We can see that the EIB is present in almost all of the biggest renewable projects in the EU, and they usually take place in just in few selected countries, whereas there are countries where EIB's investments in renewables are really minimal, if at all happens. So there are countries like Bulgaria, Luxembourg, Latvia, Poland, where this lending is almost inexistent. So for the EIB to really be a climate action leader, it needs to strengthen efforts to diversify its energy efficiency and renewable investments by adopting very thorough country-tailored approaches linked with the national energy and climate plans of these countries, which they would have to present to the European Commission soon. So thank you. So if you have questions to these numbers, they are very welcome.
Right. Thank you, Anna. We're moving on to Xavier.
Yes. Hello, everyone. I will basically build on what Anna was describing about the figures and the state of play at the EIB by looking into the key challenges ahead, looking in 2019. One key challenge, I think, for the European Investment Bank would be to show that it's really serious on climate. In the press conference, it's very likely that the EIB president, Mr. Hoyer, will present a very positive image of the bank's lending and the climate action. For example, by mentioning some of the positive, dimensions. For example, the fact that indeed there is a climate target at the EIB. It does 25% approximately of its overall portfolio. This is invested in climate-friendly projects. So there is this 25% target. Also, a 35% target for climate for investments in developing countries. Also, that the fact that the EIB is issuing a lot of green bonds and is a leader in that field. But as Anya said, there is a darker side to the lending and a problem of consistency with portraying itself as a climate leader, but at the same time, still investing heavily into fossil fuels and projects that are detrimental to climate objectives. Before the COP in Paris, the EIB also adopted a climate strategy, which is now declined in different action plans. In this strategy, what is clearly spelled out is that all policies of the bank, including the sectoral ones, for example, in the energy field, need to be aligned with those objectives of the bank on climate and with the objective of keeping global warming well below 2 degrees. But that was a few years ago. Since then, the situation changed because there has been, for example, this infamous report from the IPCC, on the 1.5 degree scenario and the impacts of not keeping global warming under 1.5 degree, the dramatic impacts it could have on territories and citizens. And what's interesting is that now the EIB president at the latest COP has committed that the bank will align all its operations with the Paris Agreement by 2020. So if it's serious about that, it means it needs to act now in 2019. So that's certainly a topic on which it would be useful to ask the president of the EIB about and how concretely he's planning to do so. As Anya said, we have some ideas and proposals about how concretely to do that and how to put these words into concrete actions for the European Investment Bank. And one obvious thing to do is indeed to end all support to fossil fuels. And actually getting out of fossil fuels would mean also be more consistent with the EU long-term climate strategy, for 2050, that was published by the Commission in December, so recently. Because keeping investments in fossil fuels and supporting energy-intensive industry would basically undermine this long-term policy and strategy of the bank. One key challenge, I think, will be on the gas front. As Anna explained, it's already a big issue with the bank's energy lending, and this will be, a key topic because the bank is still using, this energy security argument, for example, to keep investing into gas pipelines and gas infrastructure. But what we see is that this argument is less and less relevant. There have been different studies, including from the European Climate Foundation and E3G, showing that actually the gas infrastructure is underutilized in Europe. So there is too much infrastructure, especially compared to the declining gas demand in Europe, and that the gas system is already resilient to external shocks. So at the moment, there is no need to build new infrastructure in the gas sector. we saw recently, for example, this week, that the MidCat project, which was supposed to connect France and Spain, is basically not in the radars anymore because it was unviable economically as well. It was likely to become a stranded asset. And these are certainly considerations that the EIB needs to take into account much more when discussing future projects. And indeed, what we think is that there is no role for public institutions, especially because it's all about public money here, to keep on subsidizing fossil fuel projects. One other argument being that the decisions that are being made now for gas projects will have consequences in the long term. When you invest in a pipeline, basically the infrastructure is here to stay 40, 50, even 60 years. So the decisions taken now will have an impact on Europe and on our energy system for decades. Another reason why this is a hot topic at the European Investment Bank and worth asking them about is that actually this year the bank is reviewing its energy policy. It already started, there is a public consultation opened, and it's likely that the final decision will be taken over the summer or shortly after in 2019. It's a very important process because basically this new policy that is to be approved would guide the investments of the EIB in the energy sector for at least 5 or 6 years. So decisions taken this year will influence how the EIB works and the lands in that sector, and how it will pick its loans until 2025. So basically, if fossil fuels are still in, it means that the bank in 5-6 years will still be able to do these dirty investments in 2025. So in light of the climate urgency, that would really be extremely problematic. I will basically stop here, and thank you for your attention.
Right. Thank you very much, Xavier. Yes, I think we will be wrapping up at this point. That said, I mean, we are, as always, available for additional comments, either on the topics we've just covered, that Anna and Xavier has just discussed on the EIB's energy lending in the past years, but also about the bank's energy strategy revision that's happening this year, as has been mentioned right now. We are available. You have my contacts at the bottom of the page. And we're happy to hear from you later. So I guess that would be it for today. Thank you very much for everyone who's joined us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.